contact us to avail the combo offer of General Studies and Public Administration optional with 20% discount.
Yes, good morning everyone. Today we are going to have the Hindu analysis of 30th July 2021. Let us see which are the important articles from today's The Hindu newspaper. Let us take overview of all these articles first. Yes, on page number 6, editorial page, The Wings of Pegasus, The Epoch of Cyber Weapons. Very good article written by former National Security Advisor. He generally writes articles related to security, cyber security. Okay, so that becomes very important. So I am from time to time telling you who are the writers who write good articles in different, let's say, areas which are relevant to our examination. So keep this in mind. Okay, so GS3 paper, security, cyber security part, the Pegasus issue that is going on, this is the context of this article. Okay, now next, shared values. So this is editorial on page number 6, which is having the context of recent visit of US Secretary of State, one day visit to India, and the outcome of the visit is analyzed here. So from international relations perspective, India-US relations, which are the focus areas of the discussions that happened in that visit, all these issues we are going to discuss here. Next, in the interest of the public, on page number 7, op-ed page, there is very good article having the context of recent Meghalaya High Court verdict regarding compulsory vaccination. Okay, so from that order we have to understand what are the ethical issues involved in compulsory vaccination for COVID-19. Okay, so in some parts of the world, some countries have implemented the compulsory vaccination scheme. So whether in India that should be implemented, whether it will be ethically correct or not. Okay, so all these aspects we have to discuss here from GS4 paper ethics part. Now, prelims related developments, Armenia to seek Russian military deployment. Now, the context of the article, last year we have seen the conflict between Azerbaijan and Armenia in Nagorno-Karabakh region. Okay, the contested region between these two countries. So from geography mapping perspective, prelims examination, which is this particular region, location of this region, we have to find that on map here, atlas. So that part we will cover here. Next, engineering course in 11 languages. Recently, Prime Minister, on the occasion of 1 year completion of National Education Policy 2020, has announced certain measures under that policy. So all these aspects, as a follow-up to governance polity part, we are going to take input here. Education, human resource development, GS2 paper. Next, 27% of OBCs, 10% of economically weaker sections in national quota medical seats. So this is the new development in terms of reservation to OBCs. So all India quota that is there in medical seats for undergraduate and PG seats, post-graduation seats, for the central government. So there already there was quota for SC and ST community. Now 27% of OBC quota will be implemented along with 10% EWS quota. Fine. Finally, practice prelims MCQs and important captions and quotations from today's The Hindu newspaper articles. Okay. Now we'll go into details of all these articles. First article on page number 6, it talks about the Pegasus spyware attacks. The issue that is going on in discussion, up till now we only focus this issue from the state surveillance part, GS2 paper, how it impacts on the privacy of the individuals, freedom of speech and expression, all these aspects we discussed. But from the cyber security aspect, very good article written here, and yes, we can expect question from the cyber security GS3 paper, which is part of our syllabus. Okay. Now, why cyber weapon is preferred weapon in recent times? Okay, so first of all is we can understand that it can be used from anywhere in the world, so across the border. Second thing, it does not require organization, an individual with sufficient skills and ability can carry out such attacks. That it does not require support of any organization and let's say large funding. Third thing we have to understand that this is non-contact, that means the threat to the perpetrator is not there. Okay, so it is not going to be the suicide attack, rather it is non-contact attack. And first of all, we can say that it not only target military but also civilian establishments. Okay, so we can understand that it is able to carry out attacks not only in the, let's say, military establishment or along the border, but also inside the country on different critical infrastructures like power establishments. Okay, so power plants, nuclear power plants and different establishment. So we can say that that's why it is being the preferred weapon, sophisticated weapon in coming times. Now, how does the Pegasus work? Now, yes, we have to understand this aspect here. Yes, already we have covered this, there will be revision. Pegasus is actually, when originally in 2016, it was used as a spare targets. Okay, so spare attacks or spare targets, we can say that. And through this miss and hit kind of, let's say, techniques were used, any message notification in the mobile phones, and when the owner of the mobile phone clicks on that link, then this Pegasus enters into mobile phone. Now in recent times there are more sophisticated methods like zero click method, which does not involve the owner of the phone at all for, let's say, entering this Pegasus into the phone. Or we can say that it can be also entered into, let's say, local radio transceivers. Okay, along with that, it can be also implanted in the mobile phone physically. Okay, so this is how the different methods through which Pegasus is attacking. Now, once it is attacked or once it enters into the mobile phone, it creates or takes root privileges. Now, this concept can be asked in the prelims examination also. Root privileges sometimes seen in news in the context of which of the following? Basically, it is related to cyber security. Okay, such kind of simple question can be asked, but technical words you should be understanding. Now, root privileges is basically it is giving the control to the one, that person who is infecting the phone with that, let's say, ransomware or the spyware. Okay, and that person is now controlling the data from that phone. Okay, he is able to do different activities from that phone. And this is the anonymous, let's say, actions. The owner of the phone is not aware about that. This is the manner in which the Pegasus is working. Okay, now the past cyber attacks in the last one decade, you should be aware about some important attacks, especially on the critical establishments of different countries in the world. For example, let us go back to 2007, where in Estonia, large scale attack on its critical establishments. Then in 2010, Stuxnet worm was used by US and Israel together, collaboration against Iranian nuclear establishments. More recently, in 2017, ransomware attacks of Petya and WannaCry. And in recent times in US, there was SolarWind spyware attack. Okay, so such kind of, let's say, ransomwares and different cyber attacks from time to time, which had large scale impact on different critical establishments of the different countries of the world. Okay, so you should be aware about this. You can mention in your answer here. Now, after understanding the past attacks, let us understand and discuss, analyze nature and scope of threats from the cyber weapons. The writer is saying that we are entering into the new epoch of cyber weapons. New epoch of cyber weapons. And Pegasus is just a start. Okay, Pegasus is just a start. So, nature and scope, we can understand that. First of all, in nature and scope, first thing we should be aware that it is not only the concern for military aspect. Cyber is now major domain of, we can say, civilian aspect also. Okay, first thing we have to understand that it is the major aspect of day-to-day life in the society. So the civilian aspect is major concern. The second aspect we have to understand, the scope. Okay, so when we are talking about the scope, we are not at all aware and prepared to understand and deal with consequences of such attacks. Because such cyber attacks, let's say, to deal with these cyber attacks, we require some kind of proficiency in those fields. And that we do not have at present. Some of the country only have, like, let's say South Korea is there, US is there, or recently Israel has emerged in that field. Okay, even China is having some kind of expertise there. So we, other countries like India and other developing countries, they do not have the expertise, and that's why they are vulnerable to such attacks. Okay, so nature and scope we have to understand in this manner. So it makes the critical establishments more vulnerable. Critical establishments like banking sector, energy sector, or let's say other sectors which are having the large scale impact on the civilian life as well as governance and the state. Okay, so in this manner, so along with that, you should understand how it affects democratic processes also. It may affect democratic processes also. Along with that, it may further increase divisions in the society, aggravate these divisions in the society. So the nature and scope, in this manner we should discuss. And finally, as a way forward, the writer is suggesting that the assessment, appropriate assessment and analysis of such threats is very important. Why? Because yes, we can understand the technology, like cyber technology, or this technology is surely, this is the two-sided or double-sided sword. It has positives as well as negatives. It depends on the person, the country which is using that technology. Okay, so the character of the person and the intention of the person, that organization or the country to use that technology, whether it is for self-interest or to harm the others, so that remains the concern here. Okay, so ultimately what we have to do is we need to build strong cyber defense. Strong cyber defense. Fine. So yes, what kind of question we can expect here? Cyber weapons are becoming the weapon of choice not only during the conflict but even during the peace time. So you can also mention this in nature and scope. Okay, during the peace time also, like this Pegasus, is there any war time that is going on at present? No conflict is going on in the country, different countries, but this is being used for the surveillance purpose, or we can say that other vested interest purpose. And during the peace time. So in this context, analyze the nature and scope of threats from the cyber weapons. Okay, so during peace time, it can be used to extract the money, ransomwares, like ransomwares they are used. So during peace time, to extract the critical information, such cyber weapons are being used, spywares are being used. Okay, so you can mention the different examples, and Pegasus should be always mentioned here, a recent example. Fine. One more thing that I want to tell you related to cyber security, there is one Niti Aayog document. You know, there is Niti Aayog document in PPT format. If you type cyber security and Niti Aayog in front of it, PDF. So you may find that document, a very comprehensive document in terms of basics about cyber security also, the nature of threats that we are facing in India, and the impact that such let's say attacks can have, and the present level of, we can say, cyber defense that we have at present and way forward. It is mentioned in that document itself. Okay, so Niti Aayog CEO or the chairman, he is the author of that document actually. Okay, fine. Any question here? Okay, moving on. Next article on page number 6 editorial, it talks about shared values, recent one day visit of US Secretary of State to India, Mr. Blinken. Okay, so he met Prime Minister also, he also met Minister of External Affairs, he had civil society roundtable conference also. Okay, so let us understand the basic argument provided in the article is that heavy on the discussion, this meeting was heavy on the discussions and light on deliverables. Why? Because no, let's say, substantial outcome in terms of any agreement, consensus on certain issues, that was not there. Rather, it is being said that it is the meeting to prepare the way for more substantive meetings in Washington later this year. Which are these meetings? In US, there will be 2+2 meeting of defense and foreign ministers. 2+2 means here, the foreign minister and defense minister together, they are having these meetings of both countries. Then there will be Quad summit. The leaders of four countries in the Quad grouping, India, US, Japan and Australia, they will be meeting for the second time this year. Last year they had for the first time summit level meeting of Quad. Then third meeting will be the bilateral meet between US President and Indian Prime Minister. Okay, so for that purpose, we can say this was the preparatory meeting between the Secretary of State and External Minister of India. What were the focus areas of the meeting? Three focus areas: Indo-Pacific, Afghanistan, and State of Democracy and Rights. Okay, these were the three focus areas. On these three focus areas, which were the areas of convergence and which were the areas of divergence between two countries? Let us understand this part. On the first, Indo-Pacific, there was complete convergence. On Quad grouping and its agenda, Indo-Pacific. The second is on the Afghanistan, our External Affairs Minister says that there was more convergence than divergence. More convergence than divergence. What is this convergence in the Afghanistan? Surely both countries agrees that the power in the Afghanistan should not be taken by the force. Okay, the second thing is that the violence should not be there and the peaceful process should be there. So in these areas actually the convergence is there. Along with that, the divergence areas, we can understand that the US, despite of, let's say, Taliban carrying out forceful let's say evictions and taking the power in a forceful manner in Afghanistan, despite of this fact, the US is moving ahead with talks with Taliban. Okay, the second aspect is that US is not ready to hold the Pakistan accountable for giving the Taliban safe safe house in its own countries. Okay, along with that, India did not have any kind of comment on recent US, let's say, quad grouping on regional connectivity in Central Asia region. They are like US, Uzbekistan, Afghanistan and Pakistan. This quad on regional connectivity which was announced, so India did not comment on that aspect also. Fine, so these are the areas of divergence. Now, in the state of democracy and rights, here there was a round table conference, civil society round table, where representatives from the civil society met Mr. Blinken and discussed different, let's say, issues related to, let's say, rights of the minority in the country, along with that freedom of speech and expression, how it is being curbed, along with that the religious convergence, forceful convergence. So all these aspects were discussed here, and both countries, though they said that they share shared values in terms of democratic, let's say, rights, ensuring the democratic rights to the people, civic rights to the people, ensuring freedom of religion. Okay, so this is common to both countries. However, so our Indian External Affairs Minister has said that whatever the steps taken by the government, be it related to Article 370 or, let's say, internet shutdowns, different steps like CAA, Citizenship Amendment Act. So these are actually the correction of historical wrongs. This is the statement given by our External Affairs Minister. Okay, and both countries are common on these aspects. Like, it is saying that US has also taken certain measures to correct the historical wrongs. So India is also taking such measures here in this aspect. Okay, so this is how India's stand is there on the state of democracy and rights on this particular issue. Fine. So in this manner, India-US relations, you should have follow up on different issues. So whenever the question in GS2 paper is asked about the bilateral relations, you should be aware about which are the focus areas of recent discussion between these two countries, areas of interest for the cooperation between these two countries. Okay, so in this manner, so again, in introduction or in conclusion, always write that both countries share democratic values. Both countries, like, one country is the oldest democracy in the world and India is the largest democracy in the world. So use these words in your answer always. India-US relations. Fine, any question? Okay, in the interest of the public, on page number 7, op-ed page, this particular article, it is talking about a recent judgment of Meghalaya High Court in this, let's say, Registrar General versus State of Meghalaya case. It was actually related to Meghalaya government directives about compulsory vaccination. Okay, so such directives were given by the state government, like, for example, if the shop owners, vendors or the taxi drivers, if they want to continue these economic activities, they should get vaccinated. Okay, so the Meghalaya High Court has said that this impinges on, let's say, right to privacy and personal liberty of the individuals. So Article 21 of Indian Constitution, and that's why it has asked the Meghalaya government to change this directive. Later on, the Meghalaya government has said that the directions were not, let's say, compulsory, rather they were voluntary, or they were directives and not, let's say, the compulsion is on to take the vaccines. Let us understand some ethical issues involved here. The arguments against the compulsory vaccination. Arguments against the compulsory vaccination. Surely the main argument is that it is breach of right to privacy, right to, let's say, have बॉडीली इंटीग्रिटी, चॉइस ऑफ द पर्सन ओवर इट्स चॉइस एंड लेट्स से ओनरशिप ओवर इट्स ओन बॉडी दैट इज बीइंग ब्रीच्ड हियर व्हेन वी हैव कंपल्सरी वैक्सीनेशन, इवन दो दैट इज नॉट गोइंग टू हर्ट अस इनफ और वी कैन से मोर, बट स्टिल दैट स्मॉल पार्ट is basically the violation of this these rights enshrined in our constitution itself. Okay, so now this right to privacy is already upheld by Puttaswamy judgment in Supreme Court. Okay, Puttaswamy case 2017, Supreme Court has already upheld the right to privacy of the people and its importance to have and live dignified life in the society, dignified life in the society. So these are the arguments you can mention against the compulsory vaccination. Along with that, such kind of compulsory vaccination is not going to be successful. Okay, it is not going to be successful. Why? Because the compulsion is not always the way forward in such cases. Rather than the people needs to be persuaded. Okay, so this is the final view taken by the High Court also here in this judgment. Now, the second aspect, arguments in favor of compulsory vaccination. Now, the writer is providing many arguments in favor of compulsory vaccination. Let us understand which are these. Okay, so first of all, it is saying that European Court of Human Rights recently has upheld compulsory vaccination scheme in different countries like Italy, UK. Okay, so they have actually made the compulsory vaccination to its citizens. So European Court of Human Rights, along with that the constitutional courts of these countries, they have also upheld such compulsory vaccination. Second thing we have to understand that no fundamental right is absolute and there are reasonable restrictions. There are reasonable restrictions on fundamental rights to be enjoyed by the people. For example, even in Puttaswamy judgment, reasonable restrictions on right to privacy. So, particular action by the state should be passed by, let's say, three tests mentioned here for the reasonable restrictions. Which are these three tests? First of all, it is saying that there should be legal basis for the action. Second, legitimate objective of state, and third, test of proportionality. You should be remembering all these three. So the writer is of the view that the compulsory vaccination passes all three tests. How? Let us understand that. Legal basis, yes, the states can provide legal basis through Epidemics Diseases Act 1897, and through this the states can provide the compulsory vaccination legal basis. The second, legitimate objective of the state, yes, to protect the people of the country from this vaccination, coronavirus, it is basically the legitimate objective of the people, right? So the aim is protecting the people and not the vested interest or self interest of the state. So legitimate objective or aim is there. Proportionality, we can understand that the kind of people died in last 1 year, thousands of people died because of coronavirus, many people, the economy collapsed, all these things happened, and that can be the proportional reason to take such actions. Okay, so basically the writer is of the view that the arguments in favor of compulsory vaccination, that means the writer is in the end saying that compulsory vaccination can be legally implemented and it should be implemented. However, we should take stand that is taken by the judiciary. Okay, not the writer. Not the writer. Writer is actually the advocate in this case. But we should take the stand of the judiciary, and judiciary says that we should focus on persuasion rather than coercion. Okay, so through persuasion, different kind of techniques can be implemented in ethics. Social influence and persuasion is syllabus topic. So information and awareness campaign, education campaign can be there. The role modeling, let's say different role models, leaders, administrators, doctors, they can come forward and ask the people to take vaccine. That creates the legitimate, or we can say that image to take this vaccine. Then also you can explain the benefits of taking this vaccine. All this leads to persuasion, and the people are coming forward to take vaccine now. Okay, so this is the way to reduce the vaccine hesitancy, not the compulsion. Okay, this should be the final stand you should be taking. Fine? Yes. Look at the question. Do you think that the government should come up with compulsory vaccination policy for COVID-19 while keeping the larger public interest in the view? So this should be in favor of, let's say, compulsory vaccination, public interest, larger public interest. So that can be the again argument. But yes, again here you can provide justification for arguments against compulsory vaccination as well as arguments in favor, and in the end you provide your stand. Provide your stand. Fine? Okay. Yes, any question? Now, prelims related developments. Armenia to seek Russian military deployment. So Armenian Prime Minister said he would request the deployment of Russian border guards along the country's frontier with Azerbaijan to prevent further escalation of new clashes. Background, you should be aware about the background, that in 2020, in September month, Armenia and Azerbaijan fought 6-week war over the breakaway region of Nagorno-Karabakh. Let us understand the location. I want every one of you to look at the map of Eurasia, physical Eurasia or Europe map. There you will find the Caucasus Mountains region between Black Sea and Caspian Sea. There, have a look at these two countries. Okay, so this is Armenia, this is Azerbaijan, having the border with Caspian Sea. Now this is the region, Nagorno-Karabakh region, the contested region between these two countries. You should be aware that Azerbaijan is Muslim population majority country, Armenia is the Christian majority country. Now Armenia is largely supported by Russia, and Azerbaijan is supported by Turkey. This is the conflict again in region, how the other countries are involved in that conflict. Fine? Okay, this much sufficient for IR perspective, but from geography perspective, look at this map. Locate the Caucasus Mountains, the Greater Caucasus Mountains and Lesser Caucasus Mountains. Basically, these are the parallel ranges, mountain ranges, which connects Black Sea on left side and Caspian Sea on right side. You can see the Lesser Caucasus Mountains passing through Armenia, and then the Greater Caucasus Mountains in Azerbaijan. Fine. Azerbaijan is having the border with Caspian Sea. You should be aware about this. While Armenia is not having border with Caspian Sea as well as Black Sea. Okay. So from time to time, the locations of these countries, conflict regions of the world, this is being asked in prelims examination. Okay, conflict regions in Middle East and North Africa, and now this is important region from the Southern Europe or Eurasian countries. Yes. Next, engineering course in 11 languages. Recently, Prime Minister, on the occasion of 1 year anniversary of NEP, National Education Policy 2020, has said that AICTE creating database of resources to allow colleges to be more programs in regional languages. At present, such course content is being created in 11 languages. So significance of this state, it is going to increase the access to higher education for students from rural areas, low income families, which may not be fluent in English. This would help prevent language based discrimination. This is the positive initiative, especially when we are talking about the NEP. NEP focuses on, let's say, imparting education in mother tongue, local languages, regional languages. It also he also announced Indian Sign Language as regular language subject in secondary schools. Indian Sign Language. This will promote the inclusiveness of speech and hearing challenged students in the schools. Along with that, Prime Minister announced other NEP initiatives like Academic Credit Bank and 3-month play module to prepare children to enter class 1. So preschooling is important part of NEP 2020, this policy, preschooling. So this is the new aspect included in education policy of the country. At the same time, CBSE has developed 4-hour training program on artificial intelligence. So this is going to be helpful to create the skilling further in the new areas, or we will call it as Industrial Revolution 4, right? So in that area, which is the digital driven economy going to be the future, in that area we want to impart the skills to the children. Fine. So these are the developments in education, human resource development. Now, 27% of OBC and 10% of EWS quota in national quota medical seats. Union Health Ministry has announced 27% of reservation for OBC, 10% for EWS in all India quota for UG and PG medical seats and dental courses from next year. Right, so let us understand the quota story. All India quota was introduced in 1986 for domicile free merit based opportunities to medical aspirants of the state to study in the colleges in other state. Okay, in other state. So this is 50% quota for PG and 15% for undergraduate in government medical colleges they are allocated. In 2007, Supreme Court introduced reservation of 15% in AIQ seats for SC community and 7.5% for ST community. So this is how now the final decision has been taken by the central government about the OBC quota of 27% in AIQ quota given to medical students from one state to other state. Fine, government medical colleges. Yes, what should be answer to this question? Very simple, but such kind of statements are framed in the question paper. Yes, what should be the answer? Just now we talked about this conflict that is going on between two countries. Yes, Armenia and Azerbaijan. These are the two countries where this Nagorno-Karabakh region is located and the conflict that is going on over the region. Fine. So D should be the answer. Okay. Finally, some important captions and quotations on that cyber security related article. Cyber is often touted as fifth dimension of warfare. First four are land, air, water, and fourth is space. Fifth is cyber warfare. Okay, so space warfare is the fourth one and cyber warfare is the fifth one. Use such statements in your essay paper if it is related to cyber security. With the advent of cyber weapons such as Pegasus, technology which is perceived as a friend could be well becoming a matter of despair. Along with that, all advances in technology tend to be double-edged sword. Okay, so technology is the double-edged sword. Such kind of essay topics already UPSC has asked about it. Fine. So yes, these were important developments. Any questions? See, the Pegasus is being used without consent. Okay, Pegasus is being used without consent, and first thing we have to understand that there should be transparency. Though it is allowed, they should be using, there are reasonable restrictions, we can understand that, but there should be some mechanism, right? There should be some accountability of these intelligence agencies, either to the parliament or at least to the executives, or there should be some kind of committee. So there should be accountability of the enforcement agencies, whether they are using that according to the legal basis, rules and regulations, and there is no arbitrary use of this spyware. This should be ensured. Okay, we are not talking about that this should not be implemented, used at all. Rather, the government should come up with the truth, whether how this is being used, if it is used at all. First of all, we do not know about that also. Okay, if it is being used, then how it is being used, what are the checks and balances in its application, right? So this is the major concern here, right? Okay, then let us stop. We'll meet tomorrow at the same time. Thank you.
Contact us to avail the combo offer of General Studies and Public Administration optional with 20% discount.